Here I have a Ford E-Transit electric van, and in this video I'm going to have a look at the electric powertrain. So in this video I'm going to have a look under the bonnet and have a look at the battery pack and motor underneath, and I find it quite interesting to see how manufacturers have packaged an EV powertrain into an existing ICE vehicle body shell. So Ford were quite late to the big electric van market. Manufacturers like Renault, Maxus and Iveco and a few others were all making electric vans way before Ford bought out the electric version of this Transit. And for some time I kept getting approached by research companies doing market research on electric vans and asking potential van customers what were pretty basic questions, and sometimes they paid me as well, but I kept thinking, well, what value would this be to Ford if they're bringing out an electric van? But anyway, in 2022 they finally released this electric version of the Transit, and they've made a pretty good job of it actually for their first attempt. So this particular one is a 2023 E-Transit. It is the L2H2, so the smallest version of these. It comes in both the box van, double cab van or a chassis cab. And these come in different sizes. This is the L2 length. You can also get them in L3 and L4, and all are available in two heights, the H2 or the H3. But they all have the same battery, which I'll show you in a minute, and there's two different motor versions, and on the E-Transit they are all rear-wheel drive. So in this video I'll have a look at the motor at the back and also have a look at what is actually under the bonnet on these. So first off, let's have a look at that battery pack underneath. This is a 68 kilowatt hour battery, and that's usable capacity, and batteries have a bit of a buffer in the background which you can't use, so the real full size of the battery most people are saying is 75 to 76 kilowatt hours. However, when I plug my scanner in, it looks like it's actually 77 kilowatt hours. It's a lithium ion battery with pouch cells. The battery is water cooled. And on this particular van, the L2 H2 body, the WLTP range is 145 to 159 miles combined, with a WLTP motorway range of 101 to 110 miles. So when it comes to the range, many people will scoff at that and say, well, that's no good, because of course they're used to their diesel vehicle doing much further between top-ups. However, most people aren't refilling their diesel vehicle every day. And that's where you have to think differently with electric vehicles. If you can charge your vehicle at night while you're not using it, then of course you've got a full battery every day. And if you did 100 miles a day, and of course you can do more than that in this van, but you did that 6 days a week, that's 31,200 miles a year. And most people aren't doing that much in a van. And that's without any DC rapid charging. And of course you can DC rapid charge this if you want to extend your range in a particular day. But if you can charge overnight, whether that's at home or at your workplace, then an electric vehicle with this sort of range is still suitable for an awful lot of people. All these Ford Transits are rear-wheel drive, and this is the biggest difference between the electric vehicle and the diesel versions of these vans, because they've also changed the rear suspension. The electric motor is on the rear axle, and as you can see, the leaf springs have gone. So this has got independent rear suspension with coil springs, and it makes it a much more refined, comfortable ride, particularly when the van is empty. And you don't get that booming in the back when the van is empty that you get with traditional vans. Ford do two versions of this motor, a 135 kilowatt or 198 kilowatt versions. This particular one is 198, but both of the motors output 430 newton meters of torque. So what do kilowatts mean when you're comparing with the diesel version? Well, the 2 litre diesel that's available in these vans comes in either a 77, 96 or 125 kilowatt versions. So as you can see, even if you got the smaller electric motor, it's still got more power than the 2 litre diesel. And this electric motor package incorporates your reduction gearbox and differential, and the inverter up there, and that's taking the DC power from the battery and converting it to AC for the motor. The electric motor and suspension sits on this subframe. It's a die-cast aluminium casting, and that mounts to the existing chassis rails. So the electric version of the Transit still has the same body shell and has the same load height as the diesel versions. These two here look like fans when you're driving behind the vehicle, but they're just motor mounts. That black is just rubber, and there's another two on the other side, so that's what the motor is suspended on. 90% of the viewers of this channel are not subscribed. I'm sorry to ask, but it would help greatly if you would. Just press the subscribe button. It's free and it shows YouTube you like this sort of vehicle-related content. If you want to be notified when new videos are released, please click on the bell button also. Thank you. It really helps more than you would imagine. So, what about the payload? Because everyone assumes electric vehicles are really heavy. That battery pack underneath is heavy. But then, of course, you've got no engine, gearbox, fuel tank, and all the weight of that diesel fuel as well. So the payload of this particular one in L2 H2 trend specification is 1,035 kilos to 1,008 kilos. And I've been looking online to see what the diesel versions can carry in this particular spec. And it does vary, of course, because you've got front-wheel drive and rear-wheel drive and a manual gearbox or an automatic gearbox. If you were to look at the automatic gearbox, because obviously EVs are all automatic, there's actually not much in it. The difference between the ICE and EV version is anything from 300 kilos at worst to the same. This particular van is a 350 model, so that means it's a 3.5 ton gross, and that's why it's got roughly the 1 ton payload. But in electric, they do a 390 and a 425 model, and that means you can have up to a payload of 1,758 kilograms. So how do you charge that big battery under the floor? Well, the charge socket is in the grille here at the front of the vehicle, and you've got a Type 2 socket there for AC charging, and this has got an 11 kilowatt charger, so you can charge on three phase, and at the bottom is your CCS connector for DC rapid charging, and this can charge up to 115 kilowatt, and it will charge from 15 to 80% in 34 minutes. And you've got a status light there which shows you the state of charge in the battery, and a button there to release the locking cable, because of course it locks the cable into the vehicle so no one can unplug you. So next, let's have a look at what's under the bonnet, and these have a lock and you have to use the key blade that's within the key to release the bonnet. And then, considering that your electric motor and inverter are on the back axle, there's actually still quite a lot underneath here. So I always find this very interesting, how manufacturers implement their electric powertrains. And as you can see, there's an awful lot of hoses still. And this is actually pretty fairly typical from the traditional motor manufacturers. So what are all these hoses? Well, some are your air conditioning lines and some are your coolant lines, and that is because the battery pack and the electric motor and the charging unit that's down there are all water cooled. And here's your two coolant reservoirs. This is your low temperature coolant and this is the high temperature coolant. So I did start following all these hoses to see if I could explain it to you, but to be honest, you soon get lost and it just gets confusing. But here we've got a water pump pumping the coolant around the hoses here, and there is another one there. This looks like it's a three-way valve, so it can divert coolant off in whatever system it needs to. This is your air conditioning compressor, and this has an orange cable to it because it's high voltage and run off the high voltage DC power rather than AC. And obviously with electric vehicles, everything that's orange is high voltage. That is your vacuum pump for the brake system. Here's your brakes and brake reservoir. The only thing you're going to open the bonnet for is your windscreen wash. And then obviously you've got your two coolant bottles, fuse box. This is your air intake for the heater. And then we can see here we've got the air conditioning lines going into the heater system and your coolant lines going into the heater system through the bulkhead there. And then down there behind it all, you can see the front of the battery pack and those orange cables there going into the battery pack and the coolant lines going into the battery pack as well. So even though there's quite a bit in here, there's still an awful lot of space compared to the diesel version, And you would have thought that would help with crash protection, because you don't have a big lump of a diesel engine coming forward, and also that gearbox as well. But from what I've read, they've actually put some extra crash protection in this because it doesn't have the mass of a combustion engine up front. But they have mounted the spare wheel underneath the charger unit here, which you access from underneath. Because, of course, you can't put it underneath because the battery pack is there, and because this is rear-wheel drive, you've got the motor on the back axle as well. If you notice this little thing here, this is just a cap which goes over that earth stud there on the bodywork. And that's because I've just made another video about how you jumpstart these, which will be on the channel. And you may have noticed as well, you can see here a plastic bag with grey foam in, and it's really exposed. All modern vehicles have this. They fill the cavities, in this case the wing, but they also fill the sills with some sort of padding, and that's to stop noise and wind whistling. But I've never seen them quite so exposed like this. And if you didn't know what they were, some people might attempt to actually pull them out, thinking someone shoved something in there. It looks a bit crude, but anyway, all modern vehicles have the same sort of arrangement. So, while there's an awful lot of hoses under here, it's actually a really nice setup if you need to work on this. It's all really accessible, and all accessible from the front, lots of space. And because the motor and inverters at the back, it's not all stacked up on top of each other like it is in most front wheel drive electric vehicles. And also that motor at the back is nice and easy to access and work on as well. With these electric vans, there is an option to have vehicle to load, and that's when you have 230 volt power sockets in the back of the van. This one doesn't have it, but when you have that, you have an additional box here which sits on top of the charger unit there. And that additional inverter is doing the vehicle to load bit. So that will be taking 400 volt DC from the traction battery and then converting it to 230 volt AC. Just one final thing I've noticed while under the bonnet here is this uses the older R134A refrigerant in the air conditioning. It uses 900 grams of it. That's a bit unusual. It's not using the newer R1234YF refrigerant that most other electric vehicles use. And looking at the specs on these, some of the other models use that newer refrigerant. So it's a bit strange that this particular one is using that older, less environmentally friendly refrigerant. So the final thing I'll just talk about is how this EV powertrain is implemented in the cab. And this has got keyless start. And these are really highly spec'd. You've got a 12-inch touchscreen up front, which is pretty nice and pretty responsive. Conventional instrument cluster there. But this is a trend model, but they have an awful lot of equipment, even the model below, which I've got the spec list here. The base model's called Leader. And if you want to see what equipment you get as standard, you can pause that. And then the trend model has this additional equipment, which you can pause that if you want to read that. But this has got everything you would want on an electric vehicle. You've got a scheduler for your preconditioning and charging, and you've got heated seats on both sides, so you can use the heated seats because that's more efficient than using the heater in the winter. But when you want to use the heater, it has got climate control as well, with three stages. And being a Ford, we've got a heated front windscreen, and that's a lot more efficient as well than blowing air up on your windscreen. So now the final thing, your gear selection and regenerative braking. So all EVs are automatic, so they're a single speed gearbox because you don't need gears because you haven't got an engine. So on this you've got part reverse neutral drive, so you drive it like an automatic. And what Ford have done is given you an L mode, and this increases the level of regen braking. And a lot of the traditional manufacturers have done it the same way, but they call theirs B mode. B is braking mode, Ford have called it L, and L means low range. And you can toggle this on and off as you're driving, and this just increases the regen braking. And it's pretty good actually, it's quite strong. It's not one pedal driving, but it's not far off it. However, what Ford have also done is given you selectable regen using the brake pedal. So the way that works is if you lift off the accelerator when you're coming to a corner, junction, or roundabout or whatever, and then touch the brake pedal once but lift it off, that gives you an increased level of regen, and that level remains all the time the brake pedal's off. And you, naturally then you're slowing down without using the friction brake, so that's more efficient. But if you tap it again, it then increases the level of regen further, and again it remains there. And that second tap is the same as putting it into low range. I haven't seen another electric vehicle that gives you adjustable regen on the brake pedal quite like that. With all other EVs, when you touch the brakes, you do get an increased level of regen, and it blends regen braking with the friction brakes. Unless you push really hard, then it's all hydraulic friction brakes. But actually, this two-stage of adjustable regen on the brake pedal is quite a good way of implementing it, and it actually feels quite natural when you're driving. It works without you really realising it's working. So you can drive this like you drove a combustion engine vehicle, and it feels pretty natural, actually. However, my personal preference after driving EVs for many years now is just to have one pedal driving, the strongest level of regen, no adjustment, and that's the way Tesla have implemented it, and it works very well, and you soon get used to it, and I find that's the best method at the end of the day. But anyway, this is pretty good, and it will feel quite natural to someone coming from a combustion engine vehicle, and I'm sure that's what the manufacturers are thinking of when they design these systems. So that will do for this video. If you found it useful, as always, please do click the thumbs up, do subscribe to the channel. If you want to know more about the 4D Transit, there will be a link to a playlist below where you can see the other videos I've made. There won't be too many yet. I think actually this one might be the first video I release. So anyway, those videos will be added to the playlist over time. Okie doke, I'll see you on the next one.